las akal kuchu de. Tadi ngaca na, gelsin sujong na putu pehanon de kun sovi chenami. Mije, lembu chuda de le ngaca na chitin jingi tumi. De le ngaca na pehanonu lopten bimi kuchu. Tele macam mana? Yang kau yang bukan, tele lontar yang lupusin, tele lontar itu, tele macam mana? Jodoh ni mungkin, jodoh pun itu, tele izin najis nama yang karut mana? Tadi macam mana? Pihak mana yang cuma itu macam tu, tele macam tu macam ni. Tadi macam ni tele lembi, korang macam tu kalau tambah lagi macam ni. Maksi itu juga tinggi ber, jadi jumpal sugi sesi kuning sih juga, maksi itu juga tinggi aja nasi.
Beginning with as Sinanam to His Majesty the Third Tobgye, and Chamberlain for the Fourth Tobgye, before being appointed as Judge of the High Court in early 1980s. In the later half of the 80s, Lyonpo served as the Auditor General and the Secretary of the Royal Civil Service Commission. Lyonpo has the unique distinction of having served as the Chief Justice of High Court from 2001 to 2009, and as the first Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Bhutan on its establishment from 2010 onwards. In the years from 2001 to 2008, Lyonpo spearheaded the drafting committee of the Constitution of the Kingdom of Bhutan as the chairman. This being one of the most noteworthy contributions of Lyonpo, perhaps there couldn't be a better person apt to dwell on the subject matter than Lyonpo, who has undertaken to enrich us with this evening. Lyonpo, in his capacity as Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, was the chief advisor to the interim government during Bhutan's second parliamentary election in 2013. For his outstanding and distinguished service, Lyonpo was conferred with the Red Star in 1974. In recognition and appreciation of his exemplary and dedicated service to Tawasun, Lyonpo is the recipient of the prestigious Order of the Druk Wangyel from His Majesty the King. Lyonpo is also the recipient of International Jurist Award from the International Council of Laws in 2011 and honorary venture of the Inner Temple, London, besides gold medal for the Royal Civil Service Award in 2013. May I now request His Excellency Lyonpo Sonam Tobgye to kindly deliver his talk.
Honourable Director, respected Dashos, ladies and gentlemen, I am going to debate on my tradition of giving the shortest constitute of my speeches. It is my habit and inculcated values that less you speak, better it is understood, particularly in a distinguished gathering like this. I have taken this onerous challenge beyond my capacity to submit to the call by the Rigs to ensure and assure and to enshrine the historical record to place the such an important subject in the record. Because of that, speaking short was incongruent and inconsistent with such an important subject. Therefore, in this journey, our historical journey, I hope you will bear with me, for if I don't speak this, others will speak. I'm not afraid of what others are speaking, but let no foreigners take the advantage and the historical opportunities that has been our own, legitimately our Bhutanese. Because of this, I hope you'll bear with me. It's a long speech. Copy will be available to you. If time doesn't permit, I will skip, but it will be available for your reading. Honourable Director, as I said, delivering this lecture on my perspective on the philosophical basis of the Bhutanese Constitution is such a prestigious and a dynamic institution as this is a huge honour and privilege for me to be associated with the vision of His Majesty as expressed through this Institute of Excellence is an achievement that I cannot claim repeatedly. Sir, the Bhutanese Constitution is one of the few which has reference to both national and international legal, political, social, cultural and spiritual values and philosophical and principles. Freedom, the legal and philosophical basis of the Constitution. First is the historic danger of 1907. The establishment and election of monarchy with an inherent succession of responsibility through public choice had democratic premature. It was a rational choice for a collective action. In addition, the history of our nation as a nation state, the philosophical perspective concerning the working relationship, the resulting social order, the past and existing political institution, the sacrifices made by our forefathers, and the norms, values, principles, and ideas espoused by and through the words and actions of our benevolent monarchs also form the basis of our Constitution. We understand that Constitution making is an elaborate and delicate, yet elegantly complex process. It's a privilege for me to be speaking on this important subject in this hour's gathering. Let me take the opportunity to congratulate first the course participants for having been selected for this second senior leadership program. You are taking part in the unfolding far-sighted vision that embraces the past wisdom, the present experiences, and prepares us for future. As the senior leaders of the country, I'm confident that you will fulfill the RIC's vision of providing excellence in governance, leadership, and strategic studies. Drafting of the Constitution. The origin of Bhutan as a nation state resulted from the democratic process in 1907, I mentioned, by electing a monarchy, hereditary monarchy, akin to great chosen Mahasamata or Mangkukurwagya, which is similar to the social contract theory. The democratic process culminated a century later in 2008 with the adoption of Constitution. The monarch himself was instrumental in developing and ushering in this democratic constitution. Drafting the Constitution of Bhutan in the year 2001, where His Majesty Jimmy Singhi Wangchuk, the fourth king, astonished the nation with the proclamation that Bhutan would embrace democracy. His Majesty said, quote, that the destiny of the nation lies in the hands of the people. We cannot leave the future of the country in the hands of one person, unquote. With that royal proclamation to initiate the drafting of the Constitution, the Constitution Drafting Committee studied the meaning, birth, types, dynamics of democracy and constitution. We were cautious of the critical scrutiny by our own citizens, criticisms from foreigners, and deflected antagonism from our friends. Moreover, we were under the blinding glare of history. We could not fail and falter. Consequently, the drafting committee studied royal decrees and edicts, laws of Bhutan, speeches of His Majesties, and the policies of the kingdom to give our own identity and national aspiration. To be religious, cultural, philosophical, and political basis for the basis of the Constitution. See the history and evolution of Constitution. The meaning of the Constitution, objectives of the Constitution, nature of the Constitution, types of Constitution, constitutional values and principles, constitutional justice, salutary provisions of the Constitution, human rights and convention, treaties, protocols and covenants, and other international and regional instruments, types of rights, liberty and freedom, history of democracy, types of democracy, democratic values, tradition and culture, emerging legal paradigms, social and ethical control mechanism, types of sovereignty, interest theories, theories on social, political and public moralities, lessons from the numerous constitutional crises around the world, the comments from the international agencies, individuals and ministries of our own people and abroad. Clauses, sentences, provisions, dictums of many constitutions and constitutional reforms, landmark judgments and constitutional writings, Buddhist and Western philosophies, and we studied around 100 constitutions, out of which 20 constitutions were studied in great detail. It is thus my pleasure to state that Bhutan could be one of the few, if not only country in the world, to have based many of the provisions of the Constitution on different political and spiritual philosophies. The Constitution must satisfy Bhutanese aspirations, have global conformities and spiritual and philosophical basis. If the context and the world's fail, principles and philosophies, basis must give purposive interpretations. Philosophies encompasses explosion of thoughts with tolerance. It gives immortal thoughts and sublime aspirations of humanity. As Exnagodorus said, quote, "To philosophy I owe my worldly ruin and my soul's prosperity," unquote. Our Constitution is simple text with Epicurean philosophy of document being easily intelligible and expressed in a language which the ordinary people could understand to address the complex issues. It's a principle like the guiding northern star of the constellation of diverse natures of a state and citizen. It responds to the changing and unknown situations. It's a mother of all document laws with expanding family and keeps the nation and its diverse behavior with uniform living. It has a philosophical basis of internal freedom with external symbiotic existence. It has many manifested and latent attributes of human nature. It has fundamental objectives of the constitution espoused by Aristotle and the utilitarian objectives of Benjamin Bentham. Therefore, the constitution Bhutan has both worldly prosperity with and sorry intellectual pursuit. The history and meaning of the constitution. The first constitution in the world was written by Sonam, an Athenian lawmaker and a reformer, a reaction to Drakus's harsh law of 621 BC. His constitution was adopted in 495 BC by the members who were all of Greek ruling class, a group based on wealth plutocracy. Thereafter, the idea of constitution engulfed the world. Only 20 out of 190 countries with constitution predates the Second World War. The objectives of the constitution, besides the functional and utilitarian objectives, the Aristotelian and Benthamite, the constitution must promote progress, stability, and values. The vision and the spirit of the constitution is at the root of which His Majesty said, quote, "Our constitution has been drafted for a long-term interest of sovereignty and security of the people, for the welfare of the people, to strengthen and improve the system of decentralization of power and provide a good democratic system with specific objectives to benefit the people of our country. The constitution must go beyond the mere words and become the golden pillar which will support and enable the political system to safeguard the sovereignty of our country and the rights of the people. In order to fulfill those national objectives and pursuits of individual rights and liberties, drafting committee considered the various political theories, principles, references, comments, including a study of different types of constitution. His Majesty graciously acknowledged that, quote, in the process of making the constitution, the government has studied many different constitutions of the world, and finally the government has come up with a very good constitution for the well-being of the nation, unquote. Nature of constitution. Constitution can be a monist. I'm afraid I'm introducing a number of the philosophical terms. Constitution can be monist, dualist, abrogative, constitutive, and declaratory. The principles derived from the case laws are only constitutive. According to the declarative theory by Kant, judges do not create new laws. Judges only declare laws. However, under the declaratory and original law making theories advocated by Bacon, Hale, Blackstone, Dyson, Salmon, judges play a creative role in making the law. Similarly, the Austin and Bentham said, by interpreting laws and giving new shapes, judges make laws. Kant mentioned that constitutional analogy leads to error and the regulative posture leads to desirable advancement of knowledge. His Majesty elaborated, quote, the Supreme Court is a guardian of the Constitution and must ensure its credibility and relevance in perpetuity. As a guardian, the Supreme Court must truly understand the significance and the purpose of its Constitution as a guiding principle, interpret its content with incontestable clarity, and preserve it as a living document with unfailing vigilance. As a final authority on the interpretation, the Supreme Court must not allow the constitutions to be undermined through misinterpretation at any time. It must inspire the trust and confidence of the people in the constitution by safeguarding its integrity as a fountain of legislative wisdom. And it must maintain an independent authority of the Constitution from other power centers and institutions in the land, unquote. The commanding vision of His Majesty enshrines constitutional democracy and the principle of dualism as enjoined by Section 9 and 10 of Article 1 and Section 25 of Article 10 of the Constitution. Types of Constitution. Constitutions can be different types, such as written constitution, unwritten constitution, enacted constitution, federal constitution, unitary constitution, flexible constitution, rigid constitution, old constitution, old colonial constitution, new liberal constitution, classic constitution, and French type of constitution. Further, many constitution scholars have discussed on the limited form of constitutionalism or a controlled constitution as a form of reaction to the prevailing situation. Generally, constitution can be preservative, conservative, and interventionist. Constitutional values. The constitutional values comprise of constitutional core values, which generally are human dignity, sovereignty of country, social justice, etc. Two, supporting values comprising freedom and equality. Structural values, which include the democracy and rule of law, embedded values and principles, neutral values, which include the freedom, equality, democracy, and freedom of choice. His Majesty graciously explained, quote, democracy is not a politics alone. Democracy is inherently about the values and principles, unquote. Constitutional principles. Constitutional principles comprise of rule of law. It enshrines both people and the government must obey the laws. Second, separation of powers advocated by Montesquieu, Edmund Burke, Engels, Locke, John Locke, and Stuart Mills mentioned that operation on any part of the organ of the government must be checked for the preservation of liberty and prevention of tyranny. It was opposed by Plato, Bodin, Hobbes, and Madison. Madison mentioned that blended as to give such a constitutional control over the other three representative governments, which conforms to the participation of people in the functioning of a government. Four, checks and balances that no one branch should dominate the other. And finally, the principle of equality, individual rights, freedom, federalism, and civilian control over a military. Cultural values of the Constitution. I have said this because some of our, you will be able to recall where some of the principles failed in some of the countries. There has been a problem. Cultural relativism is a view that those who belong to one culture cannot form a valid judgment of any culture, institutions, and belief. Edmund Burke, principles of, quote, respect for the inherent rights and for established custom. No single generation has a right to destroy the agreed and inherent fabric of the society, unquote. Indeed, culture is a product of tested experience and the distilled belief of people to promote self-determination and self-defense. Therefore, Mark Thompson said, quote, like Montesquieu, Hegel believed that the best constitution for a nation is derived from its own specific cultural, historical, climatic, and geographical condition, unquote. Constitution is neither an abandonment of the past nor resistance to change. The constitution must respect and build on the golden past shaped by the situation. Provisions of the Constitution should be preserved to maintain certain existing practices to avoid deterioration, reformative to assuring certain aspirations and interventionist to uphold and protect the spirit of the Constitution. Royal decrees, acts of Bhutan, speeches of their magistrates, Paul and their policies reflect the wisdom of the ages and lessons for the future. Thus, His Majesty elucidated, quote, our country is a very small, less populated and landlocked. Therefore, our culture and heritage play an important role as our identity and also for the sovereignty and security of our country. Our tradition and cultures are true identity of our country's sovereignty. That is why culture and tradition is the foundation of our country's sovereignty and security, unquote. Fundamental rights. Rights are empowerment of the people that will preserve with the general knowledge and vigilance by the people. Law should be for the welfare of the society as a whole, and rights of individual should be protected and respected. Fundamental rights protect the dignity of individual as a human being. Protection of fundamental rights is the best way to promote the just and tolerant society. Fundamental rights limit the power of legislature, secure individual liberty, barricade from the tyranny of majority, and provide the security for the development of his or her fullest potentiality. Our Constitution thus incorporates vertical rights of an individual against the state and horizontal rights among the individuals, such as absolute right, civil rights, political rights, social and cultural rights, collective rights, distributive rights, divine rights, economic rights, emergent rights, inalienable rights, individual rights, inherent rights, negative and positive rights, perfect rights, personal rights, progressive rights, proprietary rights, sovereignty and natural rights, standing rights, defensive rights, substantive rights, and non-derogable rights. Therefore, Mr. K.K. Venugopal, Senior Advocate of the Supreme Court of India and our advisor, concluded his correction of the draft constitution of Bhutan by recording, quote, here ends the most modern constitution with maximum fundamental rights, unquote. Under the constitution guaranteed the civil liberties and their enforcement as explained in Article 7. This is an assurance of protection of civil rights, liberties, which is essence of democracy. Fundamental rights protect the dignity of individual and human being. Protection of fundamental rights is the best way to promote a just and tolerant society. Section 7, Article 23 is a standing right that enables a citizen to sue for the breach of their rights. The United States remedied their lacunae in the Bill of Rights by judicial activism or juridification. Section 17 of Article 7 guarantees the protection against torture and all forms of degrading treatment, incorporating the substance of UN Convention against Torture, and Section 18 abolishes the capital punishment. These provisions under Article 7 provide vertical rights of individuals against the state, also cater to the positive horizontal right among the individuals. Therefore, Dr. Ambedkar, chairman of the Drafting Committee of the Indian Constitution, stated, quote, the real distinction between the two is non-fundamental rights are created by agreement between parties, while fundamental rights are the gift of the law. Before fundamental rights are the gift of the law of the state. It does not follow the state, cannot equal, qualify them, unquote. Our constitution thus confers the first generation of rights in the nature of civil and political rights. Second generation rights are concerning the rights of economic, social, and cultural rights. And third generation of rights pertaining to the solidarity right, such as right to peace, happiness, clean environment. The interests of the society may be predominant over the individual interests because of larger and public interests must far outweigh the smaller ones. But there are certain rights which are non-derogable rights. Even in emergencies, these rights cannot be trampled upon or suspended. In almost all the variations, constitution liberalism argues that human beings have certain natural and inalienable rights, and the government must accept it them as a basic law, limiting its own powers to secure them. Chairman Waldron mentioned about the deliberative entitlements and epistemic capacity of rights holders. Now there are many other things which I have described. I am not going to read all. I think so there is an elaboration of liberty, how we have dealt with liberty, philosophy of liberty, the fundamental duties which are very special to Bhutan, the origin and the history of freedom. Freedom was probably, I will read this. Freedom is a right and supreme good. The freedom and the liberty under the Constitution is sovereignty of people and country, and the country is absolute. There is a powers, the hierarchy of powers, and this is an absolute right. The birth of freedom is on 21st September 490 BC in Athens. Russell mentioned that the freedom is supreme good. Types of freedom, I thought you should know that. Personal freedom, political freedom, economic freedom, freedom of religion, positive freedom, intellectual freedom, and freedom of choice. Negative freedom and positive freedom, same as a determination or autonomy, were distinguished by Kant. Negative freedom consists in absence of coercion and absence of interference from other people. Democracy, constitution of a nation, promote democracy. Thus we surveyed epistemology and evolution of democracy. Historically, Leibniz invented democracy in 538 BC. The word democracy combined the element demos, which means people, and a kratos, a force or the power. Aristotle was a thinker of the classical Greek period, whose political theories, like those of Plato, set the bounds of political discourse throughout the Middle Ages. His work still exercises profound influence. Long before democracy flourished in ancient Greece, the concept took root in the independent republic of Vaishali in India. In response to the changes and the different situations, we recorded 43 types of democracy. In Bhutan, democracy and constitutionalism were shaped in the historical settings of the country. Election of dates, zongdus, National Assembly, decentralization, DYK and DYT, the Council of Ministers, etc., created a political system in which every Bhutanese citizen became member of the government. Bhutan had both participatory and representative democracy in which all citizens took part in the day-to-day administration of state through DYK, DYT, and the National Assembly. Although the pure and the direct democracies are viewed as impartial, impractical, the Tobgye, DYK, DYT, and National Assembly were institutions that in certain respects resembled direct democracy. This I can elaborate sometime later. Objective of democracy. Democracy is to be the rule of public opinion in the form of individual and self-determination. The Constitution must advance individual and national potential. Therefore, Gandhiji elucidated that, quote, "My notion of democracy is that under it, the weakest shall have the same opportunities as the strongest," unquote. Tobgye mentioned democracy, quote, "Democracy does not create strong ties between the people, but it does make living together easier." Russell even commented that, quote, "Democracy makes social progress possible." His Majesty was keen to ensure participation and involvement of people of Bhutan in the democratic process. The first draft of the Constitution was publicly distributed and simultaneously launched in the internet. After receiving feedback and comments, the second draft was distributed to every household and every institution in the country, as well as to all the international organizations based in Thimphu. Moreover, Their Majesty, the fourth and the fifth king, conducted nationwide consultation to discuss the constitution with the people of 20 districts. It was a crucial move to the creation of inclusive democracy, recognizing people's participatory role in governance. In the first session of Parliament, His Majesty, on May 10, 2008, His Majesty said, quote, "The highest achievement of 100 years of monarchy has been the constant nurturing of democracy. I hereby return to our people the powers that have been vested in our kings by our forefathers 100 years ago," unquote. Then I will leave the rest for you to read. There are certain important, I can't say non-existent in other countries, but very few, salutary provisions of the Constitution. This salutary, helpful. Some of the salutary provisions of the Constitution are: the king is voluntarily, the king is to voluntarily step down in favor of his successor at the age of 65 years, and when he abdicates for a willful violation of the Constitution. It is an exemplary provision. No immunities are granted to the members of Parliament to cover corrupt practices. This is political morality. Any member of National Council belonging to any political party is disqualified from being member of the council. Article 15 relating to the political confines, national election of the National Assembly to only political parties, which would prevent post-election horse trading, otherwise the small parties of independent for power in the absence of clear electoral verdict, that is usual elsewhere. Defection after election is also forbidden in our constitution. Election campaigning is provided to curb the malpractices and to promote political morality. Article 17 prescribes the membership of the National Assembly as an essential qualification for the office of Prime Minister to ensure the true representation of people in that office. Also, no person shall hold office as Prime Minister for more than 2 terms. Article 27 states, Article 33 provides that the Constitution shall not be amended during emergency, and the constitutional remedy for enforcement of non-derogable civil liberties cannot be suspended. Survival of our, and this is a very important part, it's a post-analysis of our Constitution. Survival of the Constitution and democracy. Many philosophers believed the political cycle was harmful. The transitions would often be accompanied by violence and turmoil, and a good part of the cycle would be spent with degenerate forms of government to minimize casualties and to facilitate transition. Bhutan looked into Aristotle's political cycle, comprising of six forms of stages, and believed that these keep revolving in a cyclic order. Similarly, Polybius had defined four basic forms of government, Kosmikos, as democracy, aristocracy, oligarchy, and tyranny. And Plato mentioned that first five forms of government are aristocracy, democracy, oligarchy, democracy, and tyranny. Having studied them, we created interlocking system and enshrined principles, doctrines, and legal paradigms in the Constitution. The Constitution of Bhutan is rigid to establish normative values and flexible enough to be dynamic, to embrace and to be dynamic in order to accept changes. The Constitution should contribute to social and political stability and introduce changes without disrupting the ongoing operation of the system. It means the society will, over a period of time, face social and political disruption of various sorts in a political domain, and the opposition party may gain sufficient power to become a troublesome or disruptive, and may take power and displace the government. However, Harvard Professor Tushnet said, opposition should not be too destructive. The Constitution of Bhutan has survived for the last 7 years without any amendment. It has passed the first cycle of the constitutional regime, and in the future, it will be tested as a new move in the changes of time. However, we must be mindful of what Aristotle said and warned, quote, even the most minor changes to basic laws and the constitution must be opposed, because over the time, small changes will add up to a complete transformation, unquote. Any amendment to a basic law or constitution which would not satisfy the prerequisite enshrined and valid entrenched clause would be so-called unconstitutional law. An amendment to the constitutional law text which would appear to be constitutional law only on its own form, albeit being unconstitutional as with respect to the procedure in which it has been enacted. During the last 7 years, the Constitution of Bhutan has ensured the constitutional goals, contributing to social and political stability, with disrupting them, and governance to pursue goal of the nation. It has mentioned stability in a changing times, in a system of election in which the party that loses that election must feel and have felt that it has not been permanently defeated. It should not therefore go into the serious opposition to a new governing party. The Constitution must allow the governors or the elected government to pursue the goals for the nation that the Constitution and governing party identifies. It needs to establish social, political, and legislative morality, including institutional morality, as Harley Nariman stated, quote, Constitution is founded on the rule of law, and the rule of law embodies a principle of institutional morality, a principle that suggests visible limit on powers to constrain abuses which occur even in the most compassionate administration of the laws, unquote. In conclusion, sir and madam, the Constitution must ensure the realization of the constitutional promise. The Constitution has become a major source of values, institutions, and procedures around the world. Constitutions are losing their national specificity. Rousseau once called the Constitution law great on the hearts of the citizens. The object of the Constitution is to provide a sacred refuge and guidance to the nation. It is not an ordinary law. It is a statement of fundamental rights of the citizen, which normally forms part of the modern written constitution. Bhutan considered incorporated intellectual, philosophical, spiritual, cultural values to make our constitution an inclusive constitution. As opined by Aristotle, democracy is most complex and difficult form of government. Democracy is never a finished product, but it is always evolving because humanity itself is evolutionary with molting process. From a self-help to the common defense, time and history responded positively. The human urge for better and greater lives. From the Greek concepts of the universal law, partial skepticism of the Sophists, an epoch of cynicism, rationality, humanism, Renaissance, Enlightenment, empiricism, romanticism, postmodernism, etc., to the modern era, where the reaction, counteraction, and revolution, and sometimes revolutionary, so the individual freedom, harmonious society, and sovereignty of nations will not perish from this earth. Philosophies and spiritualism expressed through the Constitution are anchored on the various schools of thought, such as ideology, deontology, consequentialism, and realism, act as a self-correction and self-imposed restraint. The Constitution embodies the hope of us for the survival and reassurance of our future, and the national vision of the greater and general public interest, collective dreams and common aspirations for unifying visions expressed in the document will address the common misery and the shared anguish to assuage human sufferings and lead the nation, our beloved country, to glory. His Majesty said, quote, "The Constitution is most profound achievement of our generations of endeavor and service. As it is granted to us today, we must remember that even more important than the wise and the judicious use of powers it confers, it is unconditional fulfillment of responsibilities we must shoulder. Only in our understanding, our duties will exercise our powers be fruitful." Lastly, the Constitution was placed before the people of 20 Zomba by the King. Each word has earned its sacred place with the blessing of every citizen in our nation. This is the People's Constitution. Unquote. Tashdili, thank you.
Polybius did it under the key clause.
Plato did it, there were some similarities. It starts with the election of a monarchy, then aristocracy, then aristocracy, then plutocracy, and then it becomes a dictatorship. Every dictator is, according to Aristotle and Polybius as well as Plato, is generally elected and ends with dictator. This is was very important for us to remember for the drafting of the constitution, for we cannot leave our constitution to the hands of unknown future. The reason being, the world has a fleet of examples where the elected leaders were not able to give up their powers, they amended their constitutions, and ultimately they brought chaos to the country. This is what we wanted. A democracy in the beginning must never be ended with dictatorship or usurpation of power that was legitimately conferred by the people. So I hope I've been able to explain to you, but generally says that it goes in that circle, and we have noticed that. Bhutan must be one of the very few countries in the world which looked into it, not because, as His Majesty said, we are the best and we know all, no. But we looked into the best, so that when you look at the best, obviously we are better. And therefore we seize this opportunity. If you did not look into other historical perspective and lessons, we were abdicating our responsibilities, and this we can ill afford to our posterity.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, my question is very small. You said that out of the 100 countries, you chose 20 countries to be there for the making of your constitution. Can you tell me what basis was this benchmark? I mean, was there any country which was a benchmark for you, and on what basis, you know, these benchmarks were set?
Yes, there were many benches. Some of the benches were too high for me, because I'm short. They were low, perhaps that created pain for my knees. Nevertheless, they were benches. First and foremost, we looked into the comprehensiveness to see that which country in the world has most comprehensive constitution. A, which country has the most comprehensive institution? B, how it has catered to the situation? Obviously, India has the longest constitution. At that time, 101.5 words is the longest constitution in the world. Second is with Australia and Canada. The shortest, not the shortest, one of the 15 shortest constitutions is America. So one of the benchmarks was comprehensiveness. So we have to look into India. What are the provisions they have incorporated? We did not want to tax our mind. We did not want to depend on our fallible mind. So we looked into that. Okay, in Indian constitution, what are the provisions? Then we looked into the other constitution like America. Also in the American constitution, till about 6 or 7 years before, was a role model until Justice Ginsburg, in her speech in Saudi Arabia, said, "If you draft a constitution, you don't look at now into the U.S. Constitution." Ginsburg said that. We didn't want that to happen, but we looked into it. Yet that constitution, American Constitution, promoted democracy. It also progressed, and Napoleon said, "The constitution that does not give progress to the nation is not fit to be constitution." So we took that. Number one, comprehensiveness. The other one, perhaps, to be which are concise. Then, this is the second one. Third one, political compunctions. I told you that blinding glare and vitriolic criticism. The criticisms are not from my enemies. The criticisms were from my friends. He said Chief Justice Bhutan is unfit to be chairman. The members of the committee are they've been ploughing. How can they become a leader? It was a challenge. I did not want to betray His Majesty's trust, and we did not want to undo the need, people's aspiration. So we looked at it. There were compulsions. They said, have you looked into the Thai constitution? Because it's a monarchy. Yes, but that part, elaboration, I will reserve this one. We looked into the Thai constitution because it has monarchy. So one was comprehensive, the other was concise, because as Shakespeare said, the soul of wit is in brevity, but on the other hand was brilliant. And also we had to look into our cultural and political behavior. That was the Thailand, and that time even Nepal. So we looked into these things. Then we looked into some of the constitutional monarchies. Thailand and Denmark and Dutch constitutions were also looked into. They were one of the 20 constitutions that we looked into. So we looked into it. And there were also some critics who were saying, have you seen Mordian constitution? We had to see that also, because we have avoided the criticism. Then the other team said, Chief Justice, you read other constitutions, but you didn't read the Chinese constitution. So we had to read that constitution. So others we read it in search of knowledge. Some we read in the constitution because we want to do our justice. Others we read to avoid the kind of criticism. Consequently, Bhutanese constitution is a residue of complex and composite knowledge distilled in short, one of the 15 shortest constitutions. So the benchmark was done. Now there was another thing. There was a culture. This was our difficult one. Because ESCO, the United Nations, ESCO, this which one? United Nations, cultural. We looked into that, was not enough. But we had to look into the Italian one. If you look at the Italian one, particularly for culture, Bhutan will go back for 100 years. Nothing you can do there. This is cultural heritage, that is this and that. All those are restrained. And the constitution is not a restraint. As His Majesty very elegantly put, the constitution is not a restraint or something like he said, some is over or some are right. So we did that. So we have to look into it. But surprisingly, Belgium has a very enlightened provision for the culture and traditions. So, as we said, we tried our best. We may not have been totally successful, but we cannot be blamed for not trying.
Thank you, Honourable. Thank you so much for your highly enlightening statement this evening, and also for enriching our experience here at the RICS Self 2 program. I would just like to request if Honourable Lyonpo could kindly elaborate a little bit on monism and dualism, and more specifically to explain to us how international law would apply in the domestic legal system. The reason why I ask is we're often asked and pressed by our international partners to introduce implementing legislation, even though we often tell them that that they should be self-enacting. Yes.
There are hierarchies of law, or hierarchies in law. There's order. As it is well known, the constitution of Bhutan is a supreme law and mother of all laws. Because of that, we said Sachin, Sawa, main, root, Tim, the root of all the laws, Sachin. What a beautiful word. The word itself is self-expressive, Sachin. Even the English word is not as good as that. But beautiful, beautiful. That Dzongkha word is so beautiful. You don't need anything, no explanation. So obviously, the first is the constitution is a supreme law. The second law is a statutory law. That law that parliament made. That comes under the legislative sovereignty. There are different types of sovereignty. I didn't read out all that. I thought some of you asleep. The legislative sovereignty is that they can enact laws which in conjunction or under in conformity with the constitution. That's the second one. Third one is called deemed law. This I did not explain, so my children, no doubt. I have not explained in my head, I should have done it. It's called a deemed law. That is the Indian version. The India has accepted this kind of law. The law that is been ratified from other countries will not automatically become a part of a law. It has to go to the parliament. Then parliament can do two things. One, make it into deemed law. No. The third portion is the parliament can say, they can enact the provisions of the international law, say, this is a part of Bhutanese law. That is incorporation of laws. The other one is called deemed laws. And it's mentioned in Article 1, Section 10, and also Article 10, there is mentioned. The international law, which are convention and treaties, been ratified by the constitution, by the parliament, ratified now, by the parliament, will be deemed as a law of the nation. That comes in the fourth stage, only as a deemed. It's an auxiliary law. So, we have accepted the international thing as a deemed law. Unless we take that whole part and make it in a law, and I feel that, due respect to the parliament, you must not hurriedly do all that. They must not just take all that and become, this is a part of Bhutanese law, then it will to a certain extent be inconsistent with the constitution. But not all. So these are the hierarchies of laws, and the other one is subordinate law or subordinate legislation. There are four types. And this is an Indian model that we have. Because of that, again in Article 1, Section 10, 9 and 10 says, suppose the Constitution of Bhutan is a supreme law. This is an Indian version, an Indian model. And we took it that because it was very important for Bhutan. And what we said is the constitution is a supreme law. By saying that all other laws, including the international law, must not be inconsistent with our law, with the constitution. So, in short, other laws must conform, international laws must conform to us. This is a dualist approach. These two sections of the article, of the two sections under different articles, incorporate the dualist approach and not the monist approach. The monist approach is particularly European model. Whatever law is passed, it becomes automatically the part of the national laws. We have not accepted that. Generally, Asian countries don't accept that. So this, the difference between the dualists and monists are that. Now, you can look into brochures. Brochure generally explains all that. And brochure explains that. However, we were very cautious not to have influence. But there's one small provision, two sections, somehow now give public international law. I hope I'm not going are you with me? The public international law is not part of our constitution. It has to be ratified by parliament. But there's one provision we let out somewhere else, and the constitution, sometimes the Supreme Court will have to say, private international law merely recognized. Let me explain. Bhutan follows the dualist, and international laws are deemed laws or could be part of the laws as parliament may deem to fit. Public international law and private international law are also come under that, sorry, I made a mistake. But private customary laws, we may have let up somewhere else. So we have to, I'm working on it also. I hope I was able to. Am I clear? Russia's am I clear? I got a lot of words, I repeat it. I mean, the parliament has because there are two things in. Thank you for raising this. This is one topic which is very important. Second topic is the constitution of democracy, which I mentioned very clearly. His Majesty the fourth thing was very specific about it. He's one man that he was most dualist. Provision that judges, due respect, we tend to put a lot of these international laws here and there. I must give due respect to the present Prime Minister. He doesn't say like that, but generally, even as an opposition leader and now the Prime Minister, two or three occasions, he said that we will be bounded by the provision of the Constitution, which actually is a constitutional democracy. Democracy that constitution defines and not constitution others define. So we can quote other principles but in conformity and not in contradiction. That way I thought Prime Minister gave a very, not, he did not explain in legal word, but if you make some pronouncement somewhere else, I think it will have a profound historical record. Or in sense of one. Yes.
Hello. Last thing to look on. To what extent is Bhutan's constitution, which is concise and composite, influenced by Buddhism? That's first point. And number two, what were some of the ideological divergences faced within the Constitution Drafting Committee in coming up with the Bhutanese Constitution? Thank you.
The second one was divergence with?
Divergences among the members of the Drafting Committee on ideological basis when drafting the Constitution. Thank you.
If you have read my article on Buddhist jurisprudence, I have given fairly detailed explanation to that. Fortunately, the Buddhist philosophy and principles are not in contradiction with such internationally accepted norms and principles. However, the Dzongkha version is much more Buddhist in appearance, for Buddhist terminologies are used there. In the English constitution, written in English, we could not quite avoid internationally and constitutionally accepted principles and others. But there are few provisions, the tolerance, respect for life, those things are there. I'm not saying that it is not there in other country, other constitution, but there are definitely Buddhist principles in that. It starts with the school of historicity or historical schools of thoughts. The preamble, Everlasting Fortunes of the Forefathers and Gyewabu, is a typical Buddhist and Bhutanese. And none of you, sir and madam, ever recognize this. We took it as part and parcel of it. And while we were drafting, it was not easy to come up with this verse. But last month, economists had carried a small article praising this poetic word with penetrating meaning. Similarly, Justice Kirby, about 2 years before, he liked it because generally the preamble of the Constitution, while we were drafting the Constitution, we wanted to have a little bit of romanticism. It's a romantic philosophy there. But people must be romantic. We the people, everlasting fortune, looking for the best and sublime thinking. So in that, it starts with the first Constitution, particularly with the everlasting one. Then, obviously, Article 3 of the Constitution, that is a bit of thing. And in Article 9 of the Constitution, which is non-justiciable, but there is a provision in that. And also in Article 7, that is a small article, a small provision of a Buddhist influence there. But generally Buddhist concept which is in conformity with others. And some other words. The Constitution, it is easy just now. Let me seize this opportunity because all of you are very senior and I will not give this opportunity again. And I'm just speaking to the right people and I will never get that opportunity again. So might as well do it now. Drafting the committee was from a diverse background with diverse social basis. So we had different thinkings, different belief they were. First and foremost was emotional. The first stage of drafting was emotionalism. Emotion, which is again Nietzschean philosophy of emotions. No rationality. So they were very emotional. How can we say like that to the monarchy who has given us 100 years and this and that? But emotions they are not permanent. So some of us have to guard that the emotion, the fading emotions must not be feature of fading delights. The next problem was you will never know how difficult it is, but how independent the committee was. When we announced that Bhutan will have a constitutional monarchy, there was all from us. Oi, Toby, did you get this? Honourable? Who said this? Who said that? Queensland and others said it. How brave you were there to say that. Third, very difficult one was religion. Religion is always difficult. And it took second most time in a ring. And it was so emotional, we often, after the meeting, didn't talk to each other. And it was so bad that we had to go to Kurjilha. Bhutan and Tobgye. You know what people said? All this constitution drafting, they are wasting money by going to Punaka and going to Bhutan and others like that. Least realizing that we never took a trip abroad. It was all in Bhutan. First we went to Punaka and to Talon. It meant nothing at that time. We didn't want to publicize it. But it had a historical relevance. If you're religious, then you say you took the blessing and put on it. Now if you look into it historically, oh, these people did it like that. It's easier to praise in future, in past, and to castigate at the present. They say, why they were to Bhutan? Speaking frankly, that was of one occasion. Guru Rinpoche had statues, not idol worshippers as many would think. The Guru Rinpoche with the big statues was gazing at us. And it is that time we were able to reconcile with Kajipa and Nimano. We could not, that statue was important. Then I realized it is not only idol worship, but we were very respectful. And that was the fifth meeting, and that was the best meeting. We were able to reconcile, and that was the beginning of unity of religion in Bhutan. That was it. The third, but the most difficult actually, well, most debated, was local government, Article 22. It was most difficult because everybody knew. Not many people knew about Article 13, 14, but NC gave us a bit of trouble. The bill of everybody passed, nobody said, okay, no comments, no comments, no comments. There's no comments at all, even in the parliament. But that created one of the constitutional crises also. And local government was most difficult, everybody knew about it. First and foremost, what to do with Jonga? They were carrying this hatred of the president. What to do with the guards? They should be elected chairman of the guard. All this raging, fiery debates took place. And it had to be in conformity with the constitution. The constitution, we have unitary constitution and federal constitution. Bhutan has adopted a unitary constitution. And it has a benefit. But then there were some bright people who were saying, Bhutan is going to be federalism. No. Under then what happened is local government, now they're saying Swiss, it's not a Swiss model. There are provisions, there are some similarities. But local government is not same as that of a federal government. Local government generally under the IMF has 4 to 5 powers, including the Swiss constitution. There is no explicit provisions there. Where we defined was in IMF. Under the IMF, there is one provision, and that was very helpful to us. Somehow, His Majesty had done most of the things in that line. So it was difficult, A, because everybody knew about it, B, also they had the interests, C, above all, there was no model to copy, D, we had to ensure that it does not conflict with the constitution, the basic structure of the constitution, or all entrenched constitution, provisions of constitution. So it is, Bhutan has a unitary system with a very strong local government.
Thank you, Honourable. Since most of the participants here are civil servants, I thought perhaps this question would be interesting for many of us. The constitution has a provision where we have four constitutional bodies, like the ECC, the Raw Material Authority. Their annual reports seem to be submitted to Parliament directly. Election Commission, we understand for reasons. And for the Civil Service Commission, the reports seem to go to the government. And we also know in the constitution, it also says the constitution aspires to have a political civil service. So I was just wondering, what was the intent behind this separation of us? And second, I was also wondering, what significance does it have in terms of separation of power between the three? Because we also know that a difficult debate we had was in Parliament was when we had the civil service law, we considered separation of power at various levels. And we also now know that a lot of employees at the certain grades and below, we have a commonality under the Civil Service Commission. And it's interesting to know what your thoughts are on that.
I think certain things I need for my retirement, if it is not too far away. The first thing is why the report is not tabled. The civil service report is not tabled in the RCC. RCC report is not tabled in the Parliament. This was a conscious decision. Number one, since civil service is apolitical, going to Parliament to, can't say wrong, but it was not right. Then the political parties will have something. B, and above all, Prime Minister is a head of the executive. So that's why we have left it only to the cabinet under Prime Minister, because cabinet is the Prime Minister. C is when it goes to Parliament, to great extent a body is not too great. They are accountable, but you can't really fix individual accountability. If civil service goes really wrong, Prime Minister could be fixed. He has resigned, retired, or something he could have done. These were three reasons why we kept that. These were the express reasons. There were other reasons. If Prime Minister doesn't have some say, now I know who's going to that, some say in civil service, but not really all his cabinet, then we will land into some trouble which we did with the previous government, but it didn't take into a very different line. What Margaret Thatcher did, by the time of Margaret Thatcher, civil servant became too strong without accountability, and Margaret Thatcher wanted to bring reforms, and there was resistance on civil servant. Because of that, she brought another act on advisors, another class of civil servants who were placed above the secretaries. This, we did not want to do it. Because if somebody is really pressed and somebody is really cornered or fenced around him, that man can fight, and a desperate soldier is the best fighter. And also, there's always some creative means to circumvent that. We did not want that situation to come to Bhutan. In UK, Margaret Thatcher did this. Civil service, unfortunately, no, that's unfortunate. Civil service, how it came to civil service? Civil service, come on, we had also. And abroad, but there were some reasons. I don't know they definitely did not. When the charter was drafted, I must admit that it was drafted on different lines. But it had the called Abraham Lincoln's spoil system. His Majesty the 14th was not, he didn't like the spoil system. In America also, it served during Lincoln's time to bring a spoil system. I suppose you know what the spoil system is, that you will appoint people which supported him. And it served at that time. Then, that spoil system was introduced. The second reform of civil service, CRC reforms, civil service something reforms in America. That was done in the 1970s. That was a reform of this point system. Then this CRC reform came, then another reform came, later called Blitz or something like that. There was another reform by he was a World Bank, he was a president, McNamara. He brought another reform. Actually, civil service rules and regulations, not the Civil Service Act, was a product of all those which we studied. We had referred that to us, to Singaporean system, Thai system, British called, there was another system called, there was another big reform. So our civil service, we looked into it. And then in America, under I don't know which president, they again circumvented the CRC, so they have these political appointees. There are about 30,000 political appointees, secretaries, assistant secretaries. When the president moves, he changes all that. If civil service is too rigid, if the prime minister has no say in that, this will result. He'll bring in another thing, and he'll bring a big majority in the parliament. Then our civil service, our pious expression, independent, professional, that is okay, okay, you're professional, you're independent, you stay there, and others will come. Wisdom or the statesmanship is not only to remedy the problems, but to see and avoid it. And this breaks stands for that. You must see into the past. Please see who else there, what does it mean, what others have happened, what others did. And Rick's going to provide the leadership. We failed. RIM started on that bias expression, that legacy. The big people will come, important people will come. Build up this future civil service. Then we became, of course they will not understand, the typist training and including the law trainers. Before you say anything, I have a few things to say. I'd like to most profusely thank the director, not for giving me this opportunity. With my advancing age now, I don't quite like to talk as I used to, perhaps used to do. I get tired. And preparing a paper is most difficult. Because when you prepare a paper, there are three things in your mind. Why you are called? Out of nowhere, why I was called? Now if I call, who else were there? This important, that's who, this, all scholars. Now can I do worse than that? I can't go, I have certain talk we can do, but Chief Justice can't. Third, we all have some national feeling, and we ought to have. Some lectures must start from institutions in Bhutan. I know we don't like to listen, but it is important to record. And thank you for giving me this recording. Concerning the Buddhism which Dashutashi Ongil mentioned, already I have printed it in, it is there on the website, and it is there in the in concern. And more elaborate one, most probably that will be my last paper that I'll be presenting it. I'll be presenting it at the international level and not in my own country. Even to such an extent that philosophy, I presented that in the Bombay Law College and the Bombay Bar Association. The paper that I presented in Bombay Law College, Dr. Amitkar's memorial lecture, was basically not a philosophical basis, but such an amount of transcendental wisdom between the Indian constitution and Bhutanese constitution, and vis-a-vis some of the influences by Dr. Amitkar, which are similar. So I presented that paper there. I'll be presenting another paper, in fact similar paper, next month in Nepal, and cut up the making, and then third, other people are representing in Sri Lanka. That will be a Buddhist, the substantive law and procedural law. And last paper, most probably, I present as a sitting Chief Justice would be sometime in June, July, that will be, and it will be a Buddhist constitution. So I'm working on that. Soon, Mika. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Nubo. I have about a couple of questions. First, just to follow up from my colleague, we have difficulty in understanding this term apolitical. I think it's explicitly mentioned in the constitution that civil service will remain apolitical. But whereas in the case of National Council, we have interpreted it as not belonging to any political party. Interpreted it as not belonging to any political party, and therefore we have to act as a to promote National Council as a principal apolitical council. And we also thought that this is a unique feature in our democracy, in which the House of Review or the National Council, upper house equivalent, is not affiliated or doesn't belong to any political party, and if you can maintain it like this, I think it will provide a very effective check and balance. So we thought it's a beautiful feature. But still then, we have, as a member of National Council, we are allowed to express our views freely in the media, whereas in the case of civil servants, even though they are apolitical, they are usually they do not feel comfortable in expressing their views and by citing the most often reason that they are apolitical. So is it taking the apolitical definition quite far too extreme? Second one is a question that is actually left by my colleague. We have in the constitution the National Council separately as a house of But again, if you look at the provision that concerns the parliament, it's also a review function is also a function of both National Assembly and National Council. But what is the original intent in keeping that House of National Council as a House of Review? What is the original intent? What is the objective behind that? And third is concerning the political morality. Clearly, one of the provisions that prohibits party defection is also in order to preserve political morality. But however, sometimes because of the circumstances, because of the convenience, and also because people want it that way, we tend to breach the political morality. So what kind of implications in breaching this political morality has, how important it is to preserve this political morality? Thank you.
I hope I don't forget the three questions. The first question is civil service. Civil service, apolitical, is generally accepted principles throughout the world. Throughout the world, it is that civil service should be apolitical. B is that if they are not apolitical, then we'll have a lot of problems with a very, we call it a very large, but to a certain extent it's a small also. And whenever there is a political parties come, they will be changed, they will have their political views. Number two, if their party on the top, if their party on the top, political parties are there in the same party, there will be no check and balance. There will be no counter-arguments. They should be able to give their views freely, but they should accept the political leader's dictum. They said, this is my view, and if you don't accept it, it's a different question. Now you can take it as a, I will give you my bureaucratic advice, but you can take the political decision. And to, for a civil servant to say that you have to do exactly what I, what the political masters, to tell the political masters to do what bureaucracy, that is also wrong. But to, again, for a political master to expect the civil servants to tour everything. Of course, he has to tour the library, but because he's a government. But again, go all out of the party line, then when will our civil when our public will be? Every 5 years, the public of Bhutan will be sandwiched between 2 to 3 parties. They will get a ransom. Then every 5 years they will say, okay, this party you out, this is 7 out. What will be the continuity? The third point is civil servants is there to give up continuity. Politicians ought to have a long-term views, but they can be, they generally short. The only negative part of democracy is the politicians don't have long-term views. Dictators have a longer views. And particularly monarchies have a longer views. And that would be sacrifice. And for a Bhutan to be torn apart, as small as we are, and that killing and torment coming down to the public, to civil, because civil service will not leave it there. You will pass it down to the government because the political masters will say that he changed. Then the planning will have no, all the plans and policies will have no meaning and significance. Then what kind of country will you have? Because of that, waiver, rebellion principle is that apolitical. It's a rebel, was the first to give this. That was the reason why we give apolitical. Apolitical doesn't really mean that you can't vote, but generally you should not be going and canvassing for the others. For good or bad reasons, for a good or bad reason, here let me not name, some of our good countries, friendly countries, I mentioned, oh, you should allow the civil servants to join the parties, final freedom, this and that. Have you done it? Of course they have done. But somehow they are very subtle. These people have some ethics. Bhutanese have spiritual values. Can't question about it. Bhutanese have a strong spiritual values. You can't doubt about it. But ethics we don't have. Because it's a foreign idea. All the foreign ideas. Any transplanted values have no deep roots. What is a deep root? You don't feel bad. If I'm not caught by police or anti-corruption, I'm not criminal. But if you kill some years, I say, oh, there's some man, same thing. The whole day, like, the Western countries, they don't feel it. They don't think about that. They can throw bomb in Hiroshima. No guilt. But they will tell the same people, don't do this there. But we'll do it here. We enslave here. Don't do it there. We will. All sorts of things will come. Because their ethics are different. I'm not saying they're bad. This is not there in our system. Because of this, we had to keep civil servants apolitical. We may not succeed, but failure not to do is worse than allowing what to do. That was the one reason. There are laws that civil servants should resign into. If they can't contest, they should come. But civil service is not a job or what you call this ruling part. You go out, go in, I mean, we don't do that. Civil servant is a discipline. The second question is, that's it, you know, review now, House of Review. House of Review, I have to be frank, because history needs to be frank. We never thought of it. We never thought of National Council to be House of Review. Initially we thought differently at what come, but out of genius of his Majesty's report, that formulation came from there. Again, that is a reflection of His Majesty's experience our Royal Advisory Council, that some of those policies, that some of those paradigms are now in the National Council. And there is a strong effect that if I have the King makes mistake, National Council, the Royal Advisory Council should point out. What a wonderful thing. No countries in the world done it. But at that time, the Royal Advisory Council was given that power. And that, instead of doing that, of course, there's one provision is that they had to report to the king. And that is a remnant of the RAC. RAC is one act in Bhutan which went too many amendments, I think 4 to 5 amendments of the Royal Advisory Act. And there has been frustration, there has been disappointment in the Royal Advisory Council, but on the whole they worked very well. And it, that word House of River King. When the command came, House of River King, then again, you couldn't just say that, oh, command of His Majesty, put down. No, we didn't do that. Then we looked into it, where it is there. Because it was our responsibility to report. That's what the civil servants ought to do. Sir, yes, sir, we will, these things are there, but we will look. And in the American Constitution, it is there, Senate is the House of Review. And there's another 2 constitutions which mention that. Third one, the law. There were 2 things. We wanted to put morality. The Constitution does not mention that. The Constitution does not mention the word morality. The Constitution does not mention ethics. I think one or something like that, this ethic committee or something like that. But generally in the Constitution, these things don't matter. The reason being, I met one philosopher. He said, these are very difficult terms to define, and they are contested everywhere. What are moralities? What are moralities? But Dicey had done this. Public morality, legislative morality, public morality, legislative morality, there are 5 morality, I forget. So those were there, and these moralities, we had to do it through interpretations. Suddenly most of the constitutions did not mention that, but failure of that has caused a lot of problems. And Bhutan, we did not take it, so it is through interpretation. What are the political moralities in our constitution? One is a defection. Another is, yes, MPs are immune from arrest, but they are not immune for criminal and corruption activities. This exemption is not there, immunities, the exemption or exclusionary clause is not there in other constitutions. Bhutan we incorporated. And they said, what a wonderful thing that in Bhutan, this anti-corruption Article 26, I think, is also a political morality. It's a morality of, well, why political morality? Because moral must be there for a politician not to be corrupted. So that morality is there. Defection is there, there are the other end. Finance, election fund is also come under public morality. So these are moralities, and you can read my lecture, I distribute this to you. And these are the moralities, and this has been explained over the others. But like Dicey and others, they could not put directly into the constitution, but they did it with the implied meaning and with the interpretations. Because prescription alone was not enough, if there was no ethical values and moral principles. So because of the moral principles, they put them. And all these lawyers and philosophers are trying to counter or remedy the maladies of the situation without changing the constitution. As Lord Denning said, iron the creases without altering the material. Then defection you mentioned.
Okay.
Defection is, yes, one can defect, obviously, because there's one provision, a section in our constitution where there is a conscious voting. This only constitution in the world, there's just one conscious voting there. And generally, that conscious voting is not betrayal of the trust. It is a higher moral, political morality. He will resign. He says, I do not agree with this, so I resign. It's a very, very high standard of morality. But he can't go and join the other. And that's a horse tree. And in some of the countries, this has been a tremendous curse. They could not do it now because the constitution has given certain flexibility and they could not alter their constitution. Because of that, there are political turmoils.
Your Excellency, the Chief Justice of Bhutan, honorable members of the Parliament, members of the Rick's faculty, course participants, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. As an institute for governance and strategic studies, and given its vision to promote excellence in leadership and governance, the lecture tonight has been most timely, the content most relevant, and the speaker most appropriate. As Lyonpo mentioned in his address, democracy is never a finished product. It should evolve and flourish. And for our democracy to flourish in the manner envisaged by our beloved kings, it is crucial that every Bhutanese citizen knows the constitution and its provisions well, particularly the foundations on which it is laid. Lyonpo's lecture this evening has been most enriching and enlightening to that effect. On behalf of the Institute, its governing board, faculty, staff and course participants, and on my own personal behalf, I would like to express our deepest appreciation and gratitude to Lyonpo for delivering the fourth Friday forum lecture here at Rick's tonight on a subject that is not only close to our hearts, but also of paramount importance. We are truly honored to have Your Excellency in our midst this evening. It really means so much to a young yet very important institute such as RICS. So thank you very much, Your Excellency. I would also like to thank the 23 course participants who have helped us in whatever ways possible in hosting this Friday forum lecture, despite the fact that they are undergoing a very intensive course. I would like to thank officers of the Fencing Tumkak, Fencing Tromde, Royal Bhutan Police, Royal Bhutan Army, and all other agencies and individuals who have helped us organize this evening, this event tonight. Thanks are also due to my own staff here at RICS, who have worked very hard to make this event a success. Last but not the least, I would like to thank all the distinguished guests and participants for joining us today, and we look forward to your participation in the fifth Friday Forum lecture next week by Ambassador Shyam Saran from India. Now, we would like to invite all the guests and participants for refreshments outside. Thank you and touch today.